Hi, I'm Sheri Speede, the director, founder, and veterinarian for Sanaga-Yong Chimpanzee Rescue in Cameroon, Central Africa, where we care for 76 confiscated chimpanzees. I'm so honored to have the opportunity to present information for the Linnean Society. Over the next 30 minutes, I'll tell you a little bit about the chimpanzees I've come to know and love over the last 23 years, and I'll talk about the threats to their survival in the wild and about the role of sanctuaries in saving them. And I will start by showing you some photos. I want you to see that chimpanzees vary as much in their physical appearance as humans do. This is Aaron and Boomba, two adult males who are the same age and the same subspecies. Chimpanzees' characters and personalities vary a lot too. And they've gotten a lot of negative PR over the years as the aggressive great ape. But that's only a part of their story, because in fact, they have the same range of behaviors that humans do. They're capable of love and empathy. They form deep and lasting friendships, friendships that last a lifetime. They show concern for one another, especially when somebody is hurt. Sometimes they adopt other people's kids. When we introduce orphans into a group with females, sometimes a female will adopt the baby as her own. They make funny faces at the camera and they laugh and play with their friends. And they have a strongly hierarchical social structure. And sometimes they fight for social status, for dominance. They sometimes fight over females too within their community. And this can be a problem in the sanctuaries. That's why we have 8 enclosures instead of only one large. In this scene, Simon and Gabby are fighting. It actually looks a lot worse than it was. There was no terrible outcome, but Hope, a dominant female, is trying her best to break up the fight. So chimpanzees are capable of empathy and love on one hand, and they're capable of aggression and violence on the other. And it's very situational. And then some chimps, just like some humans, are nicer than other ones. This is a free living male, and I took this picture last year near the sanctuary. Aside from their intrinsic value as fascinating, intelligent animals and our closest relatives on the planet, chimps are very important for the forest ecosystem because they maintain the distribution and the genetic variation of some tree species. And before I knew any of that, I was sometimes really surprised at the number of seeds that I saw in the feces of this guy and some of his friends around the sanctuary. But they're primarily fruit eaters. And because of their large size, they can swallow and carry a lot of large seeds in their GI tracts. And their home ranges vary from 7 to 41 kilometers squared, or sometimes more in certain types of forest. And they typically move 2 to 3 kilometers in any given day, and sometimes up to 10 kilometers. So they disperse seeds over long distances. And they're especially important for fruits with big seeds that can't be blown around on the wind. There's a possibility that passing through the GI tracts of chimps helps the germination process of the seeds. This is an example. These are two of our chimps on the left, Rob and Masamba. And they're eating a Myrianthus fruit. And this fruit grows wild in the forest. It's a favorite of chimps. And each of these little corrugations has, the chimps break those off and it had the little sections have a sweet juice and a seed inside. So when they drink the juice, they swallow the seed as well. They're really important for dispersing this particular tree, and they're successful because there's a lot of them around us. The chimpanzee species is divided into 4 subspecies, and we have 2 of those in Cameroon. We have Pantroglodytes troglodytes, which is the Central African subspecies and is present in most Central African countries. And we have Pantroglodytes elioti, which only lives in Nigeria and Cameroon. And it's the most endangered subspecies with only a few thousand left. And all the subspecies together, there's only estimated 170,000 to 300,000 left. And there were at least 1 million at the beginning of the 20th century. And the problem, in the most basic terms, is that as humans expanded our range, the safe range for chimpanzees dramatically decreased. And now, three times more of chimpanzee habitat is in logging concessions as in protected areas. And chimpanzees are particularly vulnerable to their threats because they reproduce so slowly. Chimpanzee females reach maturity around 12 years. And on average, they have their first babies at 15 years. And they nurse their babies for a long time. So they only have babies every 4 to 5 years. So if there are deaths in a community, especially a significant number of deaths, it's really hard for that population to rebound. And the most significant threats, the primary threats to chimpanzees, are poaching, habitat loss, and disease. And they're all tied in together. And I'm going to talk about poaching for the bushmeat trade first, because it is arguably the most immediate threat to the survival of chimpanzees in Central Africa. And it's also, my organization deals with the fallout of it every day. So bushmeat, I want to talk about bushmeat quickly. It refers to any animal from the forest that's killed and eaten. It's not specifically chimpanzees and gorillas, but chimpanzees and gorillas are among the animals who are eaten for bushmeat. And I don't want to spoil any appetites right here at lunchtime, so I'm not going to show you a lot of graphic pictures, but I will show you one. This is a very common scene in Cameroon bushmeat markets. I won't leave this up for very long, but I wanted to talk a little bit about it. Not all bushmeat the commercial bushmeat trade is prohibited by law, but the way it's carried out without the required permits, with illegal guns, with illegal traps, using night hunting, ignoring quotas, most of it actually is carried out in an illegal way. And it's never legal to kill a chimpanzee or gorilla and some other endangered species. They're completely protected. But the problem is lax law enforcement that stems from both a lack of political will and a lack of resources. And in case anybody has a misconception that the commercial bushmeat trade is about poor people eating whatever they have to survive, I want to distinguish it between traditional hunting that happens close to the villages. And historically, people in Central Africa lived close to the forest, and they lived off the land, hunting and gathering and farming. But about 70 years ago, as the population growth increased and the rate of urbanization also increased, and people started congregating in cities, and they took their taste for bushmeat and their tradition of eating it with them into the cities, and they created the demand that's fed this commercial bushmeat trade. And while animals from the forest are cheap to eat if you're living next to the forest, by the time they're transported to the cities and pass through multiple middlemen, it's not cheap anymore. And the cost of domestic meat varies from depending on where you live in Africa, but in Cameroon and other Central African countries, the cost of bushmeat in urban areas, bushmeat in general, is more expensive than the meat of cows or chickens or goats or fish. And chimpanzee and gorilla meat are especially expensive. And that's a meat for the affluent. They serve it at holiday time and to honor their guest. Habitat loss and fragmentation fuel the bushmeat trade. And the most widespread cause of habitat loss and fragmentation in the range of Africa's great apes is logging. This photo from 2008 is of Anya Sochel, our sanctuary manager at the time, and she's in the back of our truck with the chimpanzee that we were bringing back to the sanctuary from where we had gone to rescue her near the border of the Central African Republic. And she was 5 years old and too old to go inside the truck with us, so we had to put her in a transport cage in the back. But she was afraid, and we didn't want her to be back there by herself, so we rode in the back with her. And these logging trucks kept blasting past us, and I love that we caught this photo. This is everywhere. It's very demoralizing to see all the time, the rate at which they're cutting the forest. But most of the logging in Central African forest, like those in Cameroon, is selective. So they don't go in and clear cut the forest, but instead they take trees of a certain species and certain sizes. But it's still very damaging to the forest, even if they don't cut many trees. Because for every tree they cut, the tree brings down others with it. Sometimes they're connected to other trees by these big vines, and so they pull the other trees down. And sometimes the falling trees just crash into others and break them off. But theoretically, in reality, after the chainsaws have passed, the surviving primates can all come back to the area, although the food sources may be diminished. And some studies show that selective logging decreases chimpanzee populations more than it does gorillas. So gorillas may be more resistant to the effects of selective logging. That might be in part because they eat more of the plants that grow up in areas where the canopy has been opened. And also because gorillas are not territorial, they can have less constraints on their movement. If their forest is being logged, they can move into another forest without problem and then come back. On the other hand, chimpanzees are very territorial, and stranger males don't often meet peaceably in the forest. So when the logging activities displace chimpanzees, it can push them into somebody else's territory, and it can result in fights and sometimes death. But in most cases, neither chimpanzee or gorilla populations rebound, because the roads that loggers slice into the forest so that they can cut and carry out the trees cause long-lasting indirect impacts. And the indirect impacts are more damaging than the logging itself. The human settlements that often start as hunting camps to feed the loggers become permanent and expand. Hunters bring their wives and raise their children in the settlements, which they eventually come to call villages. And other settlements sprout up all along the roads the loggers leave behind. The population of Cameroon is growing by 600,000 people a year. And while urbanization continues, this level of population growth is more than cities can absorb. There are very limited opportunities in urban areas, especially for the poor and uneducated. So people branch out into the forest. They live off the land, slashing and burning forests for subsistence, agriculture, and hunting forest animals. And the kids and grandkids of the village founders grow up and need their own houses and their own farms, and takes more and more great ape habitat. This is happening thousands and thousands of times all over the habitat of great apes. And back to bushmeat, the roads serve as conduits for commercial hunters, including the poachers of chimpanzees and gorillas and other endangered species. And some of the commercial poachers live permanently in the new villages and transport the animals they kill out along the roads left by the loggers. And others live outside and use the roads to travel in and access the wildlife. It's a huge, huge problem. And the forests are being emptied of their wildlife. And another thing that happens is small-scale illegal loggers follow the roads of the big companies after they leave. This is a picture I took quite a few years ago, after we found this guy in the forest near the sanctuary. And they cut other species and smaller trees, and they don't have big trucks like the big logging companies. So they cut the logs into planks right in the forest and then load them onto smaller trucks. And they cause further degradation of the habitat. And all of these humans that come into chimpanzee habitat bring diseases with them. They bring parasites and viruses that the chimps don't have any immunity to. We try very hard to keep the chimps at the sanctuary from catching our diseases. But when they do catch a cold, which is no big deal to humans, the chimps can become quite sick. They're also, the smaller populations are more vulnerable to diseases that are already in the forest, diseases like Ebola that are transmitted from other wildlife. Mineral mining and oil and gas development are not as widespread as logging, but they're still causing devastation in many parts of Central Africa, including Cameroon. And more studies need to be done to determine the severity of the immediate impact of these extractive industries, but they may well be worse than logging. And we know they have all the negative indirect impacts that logging does, plus more potential for pollution of waterways that wildlife and humans depend on to survive. And they're expected to increase dramatically in coming years. The industrial agriculture that has devastated the habitat of orangutans in Indonesia is becoming more of a problem in Central Africa. We have palm and banana and rubber and tea plantations popping up and taking precious habitat. So what's the ultimate solution? Curb the rapidly growing demand for natural resources from the global economy. This would mean developing and developed countries turning to green economies and investing research into alternatives for minerals that are mined in great ape habitat, like the cobalt for our cell phones that we can't seem to live without anymore. And it would mean population control as well as green economies in the emerging markets of Asia and Africa that are expected to have greater and greater demand for wood in the coming decades. But governments and extractive industries and funders could start doing a lot better right now. They can partner with conservation NGOs to make protecting great apes and great ape habitat a necessity rather than an afterthought to profits. Governments can have passed better legislation and there can be better enforcement of existing laws, but that would mean them getting a grip on corruption. There could be conditionality in lending. Funders like the World Bank could place consistent and enforceable standards for the programs that it funds. There should be reform of CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species. It's a treaty that has 183 countries as signatories, but it's rendered ineffective by corruption and lax enforcement, and it should be reformed. Wood certification programs that certify that wood is coming from from forests that are responsibly managed using reduced impact logging methods. But at the moment, that should be universal. And at the moment, a very small fraction of wood from Africa is certified. But for any of these macro programs to work, there need to be programs on a micro level that involve the local indigenous people. And there are such programs at work, albeit at very limited locations. I founded Sanaga-Yong Chimpanzee Rescue 23 years ago in what was then a logging concession. And it provides examples of localized micro programs that do work. We currently care for 76 confiscated chimpanzees, ranging in age from around 2 years to over 50 years. And on the left of this slide, there are three chimpanzees, Colby, Tamara, and Endem, and they're all around 2 years old. They're with their caregiver, Annette. And on the right side is Jackie, who's in his late 50s, and he was one of the first three chimpanzees we rescued in 1999. And the two chimps behind him, Mwabi and Mado, were rescued around 20 years ago as infants, and they've grown up at the sanctuary. By providing permanent homes for confiscated chimpanzees, we enable authorities to enforce their laws against illegal trafficking. And we also provide logistical and technical assistance oftentimes. And we are sometimes the source of information about illegal trafficking that leads authorities to be able to act. All of the chimpanzees at the sanctuary were orphaned and taken captive by poachers. And most, if not all, were byproducts of the bushmeat trade. Their mothers were killed for meat, and the babies were a bonus if the poacher could find a buyer. But there's a growing international trade in live chimpanzees, as well as other wildlife, to feed the demand of private collectors and disreputable zoos. primarily in North Africa, the Middle East, and Asia, as I understand it. Poachers involved with this international trade target mothers specifically for their babies. While most chimpanzees smuggled out of their home countries are undoubtedly babies, they're certainly easier to move around. These two older adult female residents of our sanctuary, Uta on the left and Mungo on the right, were confiscated as adults in 2017 at the Douala Cameroon Airport, just before they were to be flown out. They suffered for decades in tiny cages at a private compound before their fateful trip to the airport. We're very glad to be giving them a much better life than what they were to have. But our chimpanzees live in these enclosures that include tracts of natural habitat forest, along with the sleeping cages that they come into at night if they want to, and they usually do. We have 8 of these enclosures that range in size from 1 to 8 hectares. And in all, we have 90 hectares or 225 acres that was designated by the government for the sanctuary. And we're currently occupying about 30 hectares or 75 acres with our enclosures and our camp and our living quarters. So we've taken some chimpanzee habitat, but I believe the free living chimpanzees in the forest around us are still there because we're there too. Our programs help the local people in a number of ways. For one, we provide employment. Asu Francois has worked for us for 23 years. He was the first employee I hired, and he is the head caregiver now. His son was a tiny baby when we got there, and now he works at the sanctuary too. We provide 30 full-time jobs, mostly for people who had never had jobs before. They work as caregivers or guards on the construction and maintenance team. And we hire extra people for construction and special projects. We go into the villages 3 times a week and buy truckloads of produce for the chimps and our staff. And it's a reliable source of income for farmers who depend on it to clothe and educate their children, or at least help clothe and educate their children. We buy from dozens of farmers in 7 villages. And in 2021 alone, we injected $20,000 into the community with our purchases of fruits and vegetables. And these fruit runs give us continual opportunities to interact and be part of the community in a positive way. This is our employee, Alfred Bongadu, posting a sign that says Wall and Bargay Wildlife Reserve. The practice of agriculture, hunting, and logging is prohibited. And the posting of these signs recently is actually the culmination of a very long effort by Sanaga-Yong. And it started 10 years ago when the chief of Binong, who is actually the chief of 7 settlements or villages along about 14 kilometers on the road that was built by loggers long ago, he called me for a meeting, and there were several other community leaders and members of the population there for the meeting. And he said that they wanted echo guards, that they were really tired of all the outside hunters coming in and taking all the animals out, and there weren't any left. I had actually discussed with him that it would be good to get the forest protected several times over the years and had never gotten any support for the idea until this day. But I explained that getting echo guards would, you know, it would require getting the forest protected, which would be, I thought, a long process. And then if we did succeed in getting echo guards, they wouldn't just keep the outside hunters out. They would stop the illegal hunting that was coming from the villages as well. And so that spurred a lot of conversation in the patois, which I couldn't understand. So I sat quietly and waited. And finally, he came back and said, "We want echo guards." So that started the process. So in the following years, we conducted wildlife surveys and social surveys, and we had meetings with many, many meetings with community leaders and populations, and facilitated meetings between government officials and community leaders. And finally, in July of 2017, we worked with the Ministry of Forestry and Wildlife to host a meeting in a city about a town about four hours away from us. And there were many ministries represented at the meeting, and we brought 25 stakeholders from the village community. It was an all-day meeting, and we discussed and negotiated boundaries. And we ended up with about half of what we had hoped to be able to protect, but there were too many stakeholders. And at the end of the day, the senior divisional officer issued a declaration creating the Wall and Bargay Wildlife Reserve that was 11,700 hectares, or almost 29,000 acres. That was not the end of the process, however. It still had to go, well, we were able to get it on the national map right away, which was good, but it still had to go through several ministries, and then was passed by our ministry, the Ministry of Forestry and Wildlife, to the Prime Minister's office in 2018, and then finally to the presidency, which is the last stage, in October of 2021. And so we're hoping for it to be signed soon, and then we could actually have echo guards in the forest. But until then, we have been, well, recently we've started with these community conservation patrols. And we have divisional chief of wildlife and the chief of post and a gendarme and a community leader and a representative from Sanaga-Yong are going around to the villages, letting people know that they are enforcing the preserve. We have a recent program I'm happy to tell you about. Last year, we brought in an expert, Gaston Bitio, who works with an organization called Rainforest Savers. And we brought him to teach farmers and us about a new way to raise crops using Inga trees. And the tree itself has these long pods that have a sweet, fluffy fruit inside, and these about 15 to 20 of these big seeds that have to be cooked to be edible, but they're high in protein and very nutritious. And the roots of the tree make the soil richer in phosphorus and nitrogen. In the Inga Alley cropping method, the trees are planted in rows, and farmers plant crops between the rows. So it keeps the soil fertile and replenishes depleted farmland, and lets farmers bring the farms close to the villages instead of slashing and burning deeper into the buffer zone of the reserve. We introduced the program last year with 400 seedlings in 10 villages. In the 10 villages, people made community plots with 40 seedlings per plot. And people of all ages participated, and many of the older people who've been farming all their lives were really excited about the program. This is Mr. Sang Sang from the village of Binong. And this year we planted 3,023 seeds in our nursery, and we have 2,723 surviving seedlings that are currently being distributed to farmers, starting with these first 10 villages that we launched the program in last year. We want those farmers to be able to have enough seedlings to have rows in their own private plots. And then if there's enough seedlings left, we'll go into other villages and launch the program there. And we hope it'll be successful. And we see it as a five-year program for us, raising seedlings in our nursery and expanding to more and more villages. In 2015, we published a children's book in French and English called I Protect the Chimpanzees. We used the children's book as a centerpiece for our classroom education program. Mr. Alfred in the orange shirt over there, the only adult in the picture, is our education coordinator. And he collaborates with teachers in schools all around the reserve and in other protected areas and some urban areas. Kids love him. You can see their art on the back wall. That has been unfortunately curbed by the pandemic, but we hope that the program will resume in the fall. We also contribute to childhood literacy in the community by paying partial salaries for 7 school teachers in 5 village schools. Sanaga-Yong Chimpanzee Rescue is a founding member of the Pan-African Sanctuary Alliance, or PASA. We're an alliance of 23 sanctuaries in 13 countries across Africa. Some of us are located in rural areas and some in urban, but we all have a mandate to provide the best possible care for confiscated primates and to run conservation programs aimed at saving those still living free. Because we care for long-lived primates, we stay in the field long-term and we learn what works and what doesn't, often operating on a shoestring budget. Each of our organizations is small, but per dollar spent, we run some of the most effective conservation programs in Africa. Sanaga-Yong Chimpanzee Rescue's website is sychimprescue.org, sychimprescue.org. I hope you'll visit our website and give us your support. Thank you so much for listening.